Let's now look at positive theology in its many forms. First of all, the most basic work of positive theology is interpreting the biblical material, interpreting that literature. To do this, scholars have to identify the real text. All the texts we have that have been copied in down through the centuries have been copied many times, and there are mistakes in them. So there's a whole skill in identifying what the original text was from these variant texts. That's textual criticism. That's the first phase, obviously, a preparatory phase. Then comes the work of interpreting that literature once you've got the text before us. So important here is literary criticism. In modern times, historical methods have been greatly improved and sharpened. It's possible now to identify all writings of the Bible in their original context. So see how important that is. When you're writing in a context, you're thinking of the problems that people are facing. So when we know those problems of the different situations, it helps us very much to interpret what the intention of the author was. What are the questions he's answering? What are the problems he's facing? What's the answer that he gives to those problems? And then you have the question of the literary forms used by the author. If you don't know the literary form, you can go widely astray in interpreting a text. Many literary forms are used in the Bible, literary forms that reflect the fashions of literature down through the ages in many cultures. I'll give you a very clear example. The book of Jonah is a very late writing in the Old Testament. It's really a moral story. There may have been a prophet named Jonah that provides sort of the person to tell the story about, but it's a made-up story. Jonah gets the sulks because God is good to Nineveh, the great pagan city. The author is making fun of the Jews who think that outside their benefit and their relationship to God, the other people are lost and have no hope. The book makes fun of Jonah. He gets the sulks. He sits under a castor oil tree. God sends a grub to kill the tree. And even the son that was he had in the desert is gone. So when people thought there was a real prophet named Jonah, they spent a lot of time trying to work out how a whale or a large fish could have swallowed this man. Now we know it's just a fanciful story to make a moral. See how important it is if you know the literary form, namely this is fiction, but a moral story, a very important lesson, and very close to the gospel, really, leading us to the thresholds of the gospel, the openness of God to all the peoples of the world. If we don't know the literary form, well, we can go widely astray. So great advances have been made in that. I mentioned when we were speaking of the scriptures that very often material has been handed down and reused. So now scholars can identify certain forms of stories that have been handed down and take on a very distinct form in that process, and they're finally then used by some later author. I'll give you a very simple example, a very telling one. The miracle stories of Jesus have a particular form. And when you reflect upon it, it's quite in contrast with wonder stories, but that is not the way the story to Jesus' miracles are told. Jesus is reluctant to have people running around enthusiastic about the wonder. Because, as we said, those miracles are a sign of God's coming. And if people don't open their heart to recognize that and to accept Jesus as the one who's bringing the message of a healing and wonderful, generous God, they get carried away with the wonder and miss the point. So clearly, when you analyze these miracle stories, they've taken a particular form that point to the authenticity of the original event. It really confirms our faith and Jesus and our acceptance of Jesus as a wonder worker, the evidence is pretty clear. So that's form criticism. And then there's what we call redaction criticism, editorial criticism. People have used material from previously developed and previously used. As they use that material, they edit it. They situate what they have to say. They might even change some of the circumstances, some of the details, to bring out something more clearly for themselves or for their listeners. The four Gospels are editing material that has been used before, handed down before. And when we understand that, we begin to understand the concern of the one who puts that gospel together. Probably Mark was the first to do it. A lot of stories that he received from teachers and the stories about Jesus that were widespread among the first Christians, Mark gathers them all together. He emphasizes the crucified Lord. He's more than a wonder worker. He's the crucified Lord and calls us to be his disciples. Luke, the convert, pagan convert, Greek convert, probably a doctor who was converted to the faith, he emphasizes the joy of believing. He emphasizes the Holy Spirit work in the church. He emphasizes the place of women in the church's life. Give us something of the spirit of Luke as he uses the material that he derives from Mark and from other sources. Or Matthew's Gospel, written for a Jewish community of converts. People have been converted to the faith, but now they're in conflict with their old Jewish associates. So Matthew is emphasizing all the things that Jesus said that can be used in answering their pagan critics. The letter of the Hebrews is a similar writing. It's written for Jewish people who are nostalgic. They become Christians, but it's also simple. All the magnificence of the temple and the worship and the liturgy of their old temple is gone. And they're tempted to go back. But he says, don't go back. The whole message is that they're only shadows. Now the reality has come. All those things only foreshadow the magnificent things we now believe in our Christian faith. It's clear, I think, that for you that historical awareness has greatly improved our access to the material of the scriptural tradition. That awareness raises problems. As I've said, the scriptures use appealing and imaginative literary forms to bring out a message about the events of salvation history. But modern people wonder what happened really behind those forms. An important part of positive theology is to identify behind the literary forms that have been used and the message they bring the actual historical events. That won't rob us of our faith. It'll only confirm our faith that the Holy Spirit is there guiding people to understand the deep significance of the things that happened in the past. Positive theology moves on from what we've been talking about, the scriptural interpretation, to interpreting the faith of the church down through the ages. Very important field here is patrology, studying the thought of the fathers of the church. The early century is like a springtime, full of vitality and enthusiasm and inspiration. And the writings of the fathers are filled with resources that can enrich our theology. So there's a big return to that period, an appreciation of the rich vision the fathers had and the way in which that can help us to enrich our own vision of faith. In this historical awareness of recent times, a new discipline has emerged, what we call history of dogmas, the development of doctrines. How doctrines, though one and the same, have had different forms of expression down through the ages. That's very important because, again, history helps us to understand that it is the one faith, but in different contexts people express that faith differently. With regard to the biblical literature, it's very important to recognize that the Second Vatican Council has affirmed all these methods of criticism. And there's a very important document put out by the Pontifical Biblical Commission, the interpretation of the Bible in the Church, which situates all these methods within the living faith of the Church and helps people to come to terms with those methods and appreciate the ongoing message of the Scriptures.